age package of 60-65, where the healthcare requirement will be huge. So this kind of technologies, remote patient monitoring, IoT healthcare and other things are going to achieve good amount of revenue. Okay, so and how to, like the last question is how to invest in the Internet of Things, like where companies should invest. So these are the applications which I have also spoken in the first session, that smart logistics, then smart water management, smart healthcare, smart wearables, smart transportation, parking system, like smart sustainability. You might have heard about smart grids also, correct? So these are the grids where we can, it is again an application of IoT, where if you have a solar energy generation station at your home, you can feed the energy generated with at your home to the feed to the grids, and you can utilize, you will be billed only for the energy that you are buying from the MSEB or any other vendor for working. Remaining energy, if you're utilizing from your solar panel based energy system, then you will not be charged for it. In fact, if you are feeding the energy to the grid, these are the concept of smart grids in IoT, you will be appropriately charged, or you will be appropriately discounted for the energy that you are consuming. So these all things are coming up. Smart agriculture, I personally know the John Deere, they are already employing various sensors and actuators in their tractors for making it a smart device. Okay, so again, 80% of the industrial manufacturing companies are using the planning to use IoT devices, right from the shop floor, from the production to the service. One of the next thing that is going to happen in the automotive industry, because I generally interact with many of the automotive industry, what they are going to do, they are now generating a network from their service providers or the service stations to the company. Now, previously what was happening, there was no direct connect or direct network between the service providers and the company. So company used to produce the cars or any of the automobiles, they used to sell it, they used to deploy it to their vendors, and they used to sell and they used to do the maintenance and other things of this. Now what they are planning, they will, the network will get integrated into the companies like Tata Motors or Mahindra or all this kind of stuff, wherein right from the production to the service, everything, every record, every data will be available to them. So what will happen, eventually they will able to know that in this region, are the defects in the cars or in this kind of vehicles are more. In this region, these are the effects. You might be aware that because of the humidity also, there is a rusting and other things that are happening, correct? Humid atmosphere. So near sea, when you go to Mumbai or Chennai, their vehicles get eroded and corroded because of the humid atmosphere early, and then nobody buys that vehicle in the second-hand market. So all these analytics, when it gets connected to the internet, to the server, then these people can work on R&D and other aspects to improve the quality of their vehicles and other things. So that is the plan. Next plan is the application or Internet of Things is everybody might be taking a car or a bike insurance, yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So now once the cars will get connected to the network, I'm just giving you the possibilities of the applications that are going to be reality in 4 to 5 years. Okay. So when your car is going to get connected to the internet, means your insurance, the quotation of your insurance will be related to your driving habits, will be related to your car maintenance habit, will be related to your how much brakes you do, what gear you operate your vehicles, because all this data from the vehicle issue will go to the portal, and this data will effectively, why I am telling it this now, because this is the data that needs to be managed by this insurance providers, and same thing, the inputs from your service stations other thing, how much rough driving you do. Depending upon that, you will have a variable quotes for your insurance every year. And count on my words, sooner or later, that is going to be reality. Okay, so if you are driving continuously at 120 or 130 miles per hour, but your car manufacturer says that you should not drive more than 80, means you are at high risk. So your insurance provider will charge you more. Okay, if you are smoking and driving in the car, there will be sensors that will sense the data, means you should not drive, and hence your insurance, this thing will be more, premium will be more. So these all things are possible because of the IoT. And how it will be possible? Because you are going to generate the data. The sensors which are going to get connected day in and day out, they are going to generate data enormously. And with that data, you have to manage that data. That is how we are going to see now, how we are going to manage the data. Okay, and this is what, again, the real time thing that, again, the case study which Reliance is utilizing, the footfall count. I don't know how many of you know that. Whenever you go into shopping to the malls, now for last 1 year we have stopped because of the pandemic. But generally, the companies or the people are deploying the footfall count kind of mechanism. Like you have your mobile number. Every time you go, they will ask your mobile number for billing. Yes or no? So you get registered to their account, to their mobile number. Has anybody experienced such kind of things? And then through SMS, they will give you deals. Now, this is the deal that you are going to get today. Or yes, have you noticed this or not?
Sir, not in mall, sir. I have faced the same thing in while purchasing medicine, sir, in medical shops.
Yeah, so that is there in medical shops. That is there in malls also, where you go for Star Bazaar or Big Bazaar or this kind of things. They will take your mobile number as an input. The Reliance is developing a project. They will count a footfall, like what is your behavior of buying the product, how many times you visit a shop in 1 month by capturing your images, because all the malls are being covered by the CCTV cameras and other things. Then what is your buying pattern? Then basis on it, Amazon already does that, correct? If you try to buy some product, then they will give you messages like this is the discount on that product or all this kind of thing. So all these things they are doing, this is called as all data management principles. So they take a customer, they manage the data of that customer, and basis that you get certain notifications so that you will buy it again, and they will try to maintain their customer base. So these all things are the applications of data management. So first, how the data is generated. When you visit the shop, you are buying some articles, means you are generating your data with them. At the output, they bill you. So billing, they ask your mobile number also. So with that mobile number, you are mapped now. So, and if you are continuously visiting to the shop or malls monthly, then they will track a pattern. Oh, this time he has purchased this brand. This time he has purchased this brand. Basis that there are machine learning and artificial algorithms which are running at the data management servers in the cloud or there. Basis which they generate a specific notifications for specific customers. Okay, so all these things are already started happening. So only thing is, we are not aware that what are the backend technologies these people are using for these kind of things. Okay, because again, one of our student is doing a internship projects, and he has been told to do all these kind of things. So by taking the images of the person, what is the in time, what is the out time, how many people have visited, what are the rushing hours, how much is the counter occupancy, all these things they are capturing, the mall people. And we normal people are not knowing what is happening, and eventually we just get a message, but it is not as simple as that what we are seeing. Okay, so there is a huge amount of investment that is going on at back of it. So the data, they have to preserve the data, they have to store the data, they have to manage the servers, they have to manage the cloud, they have to take the information out of that data. All these things are happening. So that is the topic. Okay, so as I said, we have already covered the two things in the morning session. That is the things, that is objects and machines, other IoT devices that are embedded sensors and collect data. Again, we have covered some part of networking concepts, like this data needs to be pushed to the global internet by XYZ protocol. Either it can be wired, it can be wireless, or it can be GPRS, GSM, satellite. Your Uber takes the data from GPS coordinates, all these things, anything. And once that data has been pushed to the global internet, then your cloud and other things, servers will do that. That is called as the topic of discussion now is data management. So there are two types of data. One is called as data streams, which are real-time continuous flow of data, which is called as streaming data, means live data. Okay, that is, again, you might have seen, you are streaming live match. Okay, so that is continuous data which is getting generated and streaming live. So for that data also, you need to do some analytics on the run. So for streaming data, the challenges and management of the streaming data is different. Then there is a data which is a slow data, like just I have told the temperature, humidity, certain data which are not live streaming data. So it will change after 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So you that data needs to be handled in a different way. Okay, so that is where we are heading now. The streaming analytics processes data on the fly, clean it, then trigger the actions if needed. Okay, so that are the challenges now with the IoT. So first two things are simple: connecting sensors, generating the end device, putting that data to the cloud. Up till that, everything is simple. But once the data is available with you, then most important thing is what to do with that data. Okay, so how you have to manage the data, you have to do analytics on top of it, you need to learn machine learning and artificial intelligent algorithms on top of it to come to certain consensus, to take the real near real-time decisions on the data. Okay, now suppose, as I said, you are monitoring the vibrations in the industry, and the vibration sensors give me certain vibration that this machine is about to fail in an assembly line. So if one machine fails, it has a catastrophic effect on all the complete manufacturing line. So to avoid the catastrophic effect, right from the raw material to the end process, first sequentially those machines need to be closed, and then the machine which is at the fault can be closed. So these all the things need to be managed at the runtime. So this is all the intelligent algorithms that needs to be deployed on top of it to manage your data. So up till this, like generating the data, like creating your IoT device, pushing the data till the ground is quite simple. But once the data is available, now important is what to do with that data. So that is what we are going to see now. So as I said, 127 new devices are connecting to internet every second. So greater than 150 billion devices will be connected across the globe by 2025. Now I am talking about not GB, I am talking about zettabyte. So the global data sphere will go from 33 zettabytes that was there in 2018 till 175 zettabytes in 2025. Out of which real-time data will, that is the streaming data which I was talking about, the real-time data will be 30%. So 30% of 175 is around 50 to 55 zettabytes of data. And 49% of the world's stored data will reside in the public cloud environments. Just like Amazon is hosting the public cloud, AWS. Similarly, Google has its own cloud. Microsoft has its Azure cloud. I'm not talking about cloud computing, because cloud computing is also important aspects of IoT. But as I understand from the 6 days schedule, some other eminent speaker are going to talk length and breadth about cloud computing. So I myself have restricted myself and not talking much about cloud computing. I hope you will understand this. Okay, because without cloud computing, I cannot tell you how the data gets managed. So where the data is getting generated, how the connected industries are using the IoT. So you can see in manufacturing, as I've already told you, predictive and preventive maintenance are there, which will improve the quality of production. Retail and hospitality. Okay, so it is used for inventory management, understanding customer preference in context, deliver highly customized omnichannel experience and the offers. Like generally, you might have seen the offers from OLX. Sorry, OLX. There is one company, no? OIO. That is the hospitality company. So once you go and stay in the OIO hotels, generally they take your number, then they ask for your feedback, and basis this they try to improvise, and whatever the problems you have faced, all these things they do. So that is again the data is getting generated, okay, and basis that data they try to improve. Similarly, your smart cities, governments, all these kind of things, energy, automotive, as I've already told, like this is the industry which is going to get impacted most, because we are going from the generally petrol and diesel engine cars to hybrid electric vehicles to the electric vehicles. So complete electronics, okay. So I hope the mechanical engineering faculty should also try to look into this domain, because major of our mechanical engineers who are employed by this automotive industry. But now looking at the future, this automotive industry is changing complete paradigm. Okay, so they are going to change from commercial, from two-stroke, four-stroke engines to directly the electric vehicles. So in electric vehicles, there is no concept of engine at all. It is battery operated, and you require the ECUs, and you require the BMS, battery management system, all these things which are directly connected to the electronics. So I hope this also should be taken care in the curriculum for mechanical engineers, so that they can be employed. Because if you cut down the automotive space of the mechanical engineers, then employability ratio of budding engineers become very less in mechanical stream. Okay, because there are continuously requirement from the automotive engineers to train their existing workforce into electrical vehicles. Okay, so that needs to be taken care. And once the vehicle is electric means you have enormous amount of data that can be generated. And once the data is generated, you have to manage that data. Similarly, in healthcare, even if you take the Fitbit, which is available with many of you, some of you might be using also. So how much amount of data that Fitbit is generating every now and then? That data gets connected to your mobile device, and then to mobile device it gets connected to your internet. Okay, but basis that data you create or you monitor or you diagnose some kind of treatment to the patients. Insurance, I have already told you, either it will be the car insurance or such kind of things can be tied up with the data. Okay, so where there are, as I have told, there are two approaches of applications data. One is live data, that is we call it as streaming data. There are certain applications like remote patient monitoring system, means your heartbeat, all these things. This needs to be monitored regularly. Then generate stream of data continuously, leads huge volume of data, continuous data. And there are certain other applications that consume product analysis for marketing, such as product data that accumulates as a source of big data. So they are not live streaming. So there are two types of data which get generated. One is continuously streaming data, another is normal data, which is not continuously streaming. So the difference between the streaming data and the big data is the streaming data is generated or captured within short interval of times and needs to quickly analyze and to extract immediate and useful insights and make a fast decision. So consider the patient monitoring system. You have to take quick decision, real-time decision based on the heartbeat or based on the statistics to the station and give the corrective actions. If you wait for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, it might have a catastrophic effect on the health of the patient. So that is the live streaming data. That is the corrective actions also need to be taken at appropriate time. Then there is a big data, that is It refers to huge data sets that commonly used hardware and software platforms are not able to store. Then this data goes from the hardware platform to the cloud or servers, okay, where it can manage, process, and analyze that data. And it needs to be treated differently, not like streaming data, as the requirement for analysis and response are different. So you might have studied about big data analytics as one of the emerging field in data engineering, okay, computer science field. So what it does, big data analytics is a business intelligence and transactional analysis. So depending upon, it can be analysis on your monthly expenditures, okay, of your credit card. They might have do the analysis on how much you are spending every month using your credit card, whether you are paying the bill on time. So it generates a big data and how you analyze it. So some companies analyze it for the customer offer, some companies may analyze or add-on cards, all these kind of things. That is the big data. And streaming data analytics results should be ready in anything from a few hundreds of milliseconds to few seconds. Okay, so that needs to be taken care at live. So generally, the non-technical aspects of streaming data is when we drive the vehicle on the road, the data is continuously coming to our eyes and we have to respond instantaneously. Suppose there is a vehicle in front of us, so our system should respond with a brake to the data. Okay, so that is something which is a streaming data, which is continuously generating. Okay, so that is the difference between streaming and big data. Now, how we do the analytics of the data? Again, we have studied this IoT devices, things which will generate the data. Some data which can be used, so there will be some data which is a big data which can be taken care in the repository and then later can be analyzed and then corrective actions can be taken, such as a weather data. So you can analyze the 3 years weather data and then you can predict or you can compare the weather of this year. Now, rain is happening at this point of time, last 3 years it was not happening, so there is some problem. So that can be consider under big data. It is not a live streaming data, but there are certain datas like you are capturing the real time images and basis that if some intruder is there or fishy things are happening, you can generate an immediate alert or you can connect to a immediate nearest police station. So that is the streaming data. So that streaming data needs to be taken care at edge or fog, because you have to immediately act on it. And the big data can be taken care at cloud services or other things. So that is the things that we can differentiate between two types of data. Okay, then whenever we talk about data management, always there will be these things that will come into it. That are 6 V's of the data, like the data, the variety, like variations, all these kind of things, how the data is going to be different. So 6 V's are the standard things that you will learn in any course of data management or data analytics or anything. So as we have discussed, this IoT will generate big data by connecting billions and trillions of the smart devices together. And when we collect the big data, we have to do analytics on top of this big data. So every data is not important. We have to identify and mine the meaningful pattern from the huge amount of data. And then we have to compile that useful data. We have to ignore the raw data, which is not useful to us. And then we have to come with some consensus. Okay. So what are the 6 V's? V means it starts 6 V's of the data. One is volume. Like how much data, billions of devices generates zettabytes of data. That is the volume of data. Then velocity, how fast I can access the data which is generated by my sensors of the end devices. Okay, so as I said, it can be a real time or non-real time also. So real time is where you are actually monitoring the live feed or something. Non-real time is weather forecasting, weather monitoring applications, all this kind of stuff. So velocity at which I can capture the data. Then third V is variety. What are the types of data, that is structured or unstructured IoT data or heterogeneous form of the IoT data. Then veracity, that is it the data is from the reliable sources or unreliable sources, because the fake news and fake data, all these kind of things are coming into picture. So we have to authenticate, we have to analyze, and then we have to decide the credibility of that data. Okay, so that is where this topic comes. Crowd sensing data may not be reliable data. Means what? You collect the data from the crowd. Okay, so some might give the correct information, some might give the wrong information. So that is not a correct data which I can consider for doing some analysis and coming to some consensus. So that is also fourth V. Then fifth V is variability. That is, what are the rate of different IoT data flows? Like if there are multiple sensors, so one sensors you are sending data, you are streaming data from say a camera, whereas for temperature and humidity you are not streaming data. So what is the flow at which your end devices will be able to capture the data and send the data to the end, to the cloud or POC? So that is variability of the data. And again, as I said, flow rate will depend on the application, various applications, time and space requirement. And last is the value of that data, that is usability and utility of that data. So like most of the IoT data is tremendously usable. Means what? Driving habits of a person, if that data is getting captured, that is value add to the insurance providers. Because if you are smoking or drinking and driving, definitely insurance provider will charge you more for your insurance. Then if you are continuously running your vehicle with the higher speed, means you are more prone to the accident. So that is the value addition to the insurance service provider. If this data can be given to the insurance provider, they can definitely do analysis on top of it, and they can come up with the different plans for various customers. So this is how the data becomes very important and prominent in IoT field. Now, how to cope? As I said, millions and trillions and zettabytes of data is going to get generated. How to cope up with this data? Okay. So see, there are again some statistics which I have taken from Cisco and some other vendors which are taking care of managing the data. So as per Cisco estimates, the total data to exceed 800 zettabytes, which is quite a lot, and a single zettabyte is equal to trillions of gigabytes. So the data centers will play a huge role in managing this information and harnessing its potential. And about 90% of the data will be unstructured. So you have to then structure it, to cleansing it, you have to run some algorithms on the it, then you have to remove the unwanted data, and then you have to come up with some analytics on top of it. Okay, so this is just a pictorial view how the data is getting generated. Smart variables, smart things, sensors are there everywhere. They are generating the data. This is our end devices. Then this data will be going either to cloud or for real-time processing, and some useful data might go for data archives. So maybe after 2 years, 3 years, or 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the line, you will take the data and you will utilize that data for further prediction and all this. Okay, so from where the data is collected, I need not to tell you that. Data is connected from everywhere where we try to connect our sensors. So now see, this is the GPS-based system where Google like Maps, so that is location of person, vehicle or train, then heart rate, temperature, humidity, human behavior, turning on the oven, how much time you turn on the oven, braking in the car, as I told. So everything that you do day in and day out can generate the data. Now the irony is that up till now we have not utilized that data for the betterment of human being. Now by the advent of this IoT, MI, machine learning and artificial intelligence algorithm, we are utilizing this data for the benefit of the society. Okay. Now the types of data, static data and dynamic data. So static data is, as the name says, that the data does not change or changes very slowly. So it is a stationary, it will take some time to change. So data about humans or locations, like a building, if you want to acquire the data of the building, building is not going to change its location. So mapping data of countries, cities, buildings. So these are static data. Then gender, name of the person, this becomes a static data. Once you have select, you have a gender and a name, that is not going to change, correct? So unless otherwise you get married and some ladies change their name post marriage, but this becomes a static data. So this is again, the static data is about things that will tell us about the properties, like washing machine has maximum spin speed of 1400 RPM, or Maruti Suzuki Swift Desire is having a variant of 1.2 liter engine. So this engine is not going to change in the Swift Desire. So that becomes a static data. Then dynamic data, data keep on changing all the time. That is temperature, humidity readings, weather conditions, traffic density on the city roads, levels of pollutants in atmosphere. Okay, so the dynamic data is about things and objects. So that is, washing machine is currently in resign cycle. So after resign cycle, it will go into flushing cycle or all these kind of things. Fridge is presently utilizing 45 watt of electricity. Your boat or your ship, someone was telling the about this ship and other things. So you can all check the latitude and longitude to know the exact location of the ship and all these kind of things. Then static data provides context for interpretation of dynamic data. That is, GPS coordinate do not make sense without the map data. You need to know the map data, and then your GPS coordination will tell you the exact location. That is the static dynamic data. Similarly, there is a real time, as I told, streaming and historical data. So IoT, as I said, generates a large amount of live data, and that needs to be analyzed and acted in the real time. So some of the examples are, real time data is, Uber monitors location and applies surge pricing. So if you see in the airport, if there are in the evening time, or if there are less number of Uber vehicles are available and more number of Uber users want to utilize that facility to travel, then dynamically it will increase this pricing, per kilometer pricing. Okay, so that is the real time data analysis they do and utilize for the benefit of their organizations. Have you have faced such kind of things? Uber or Ola dynamic pricing, search pricing, has anybody has observed such kind of thing? Because I have observed such kind of things. So these are the real case scenarios of the data that is getting generated. Similarly, union specific railroad user sensors to detect problems with wheel bearing that could cause derailment. I have told you one example of ultrasonic sensors where they have, Indian Railways has deployed to detect the cracks between the tracks. Another is, the infrared sensors on the track take over 20 million temperature readings of the train wheels in a day. The track side microphone listens the noise and indicates the damaged bearings in the wheels. And these readings are analyzed for unusual patterns on the real time, so to avoid the catastrophic accidents. Okay. And then that was the streaming data. Now big data, lot of data is generated from the sensors. A single sensor reading can tell us there is a smoke in a room or not. So every time your data need not to be a big. So there is a difference between a big data or small data. As I said, one example is a simple smoke sensor with one reading can tell me there is a smoke in the room or not. So that for that you don't require a big data. Data need not to be generated continuously. Or a single coordinate will tell you the location of any object or animal. So you don't require to generate continuously data for that. So that comes under small data. So very small data can be highly significant in telling what is happening. Means which light is on or off. That is a small data, or one or zero, but it will give you indications where what is the current status of the light. So these data points have significance in long term and aggregated to identify the trends. Okay, now I have given one example of Fitbit, so which can be directly measured, such as heart rate, temperature. So you can measure the heart rate and temperature, and then you can analyze the data. This has been taken from the Fitbit website. Another is your electricity meter reading over a period of time suggests that whether someone is available in the house or not. Because even though we are not available in the house, but still there are some appliances which are on, such as your fridge. Yes or no? Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes, sir.
So there are certain more appliances which you might keep on even though you are not at the home. But if I want to analyze whether you are available at the home or not, I need to see the pattern. Okay. So if now suppose I am sitting, so I am utilizing my laptop, so charger is on, fan is on. So I can say that it is not a normal condition. Electricity consumption is more, means someone is there at the home. Okay. So similarly, your bed sensors shows that a senior citizen is not up by 9 a.m., indicating something is wrong. Okay. If you have time, I can tell you a very funny application which my students have designed. Okay. With this, that is came to my mind. They have designed the occupancy of barber. So generally, in cities like Pune, Mumbai, the original owner of the saloon is different, and he deploys certain employee, and at the end he just take x amount of money and remaining that is given. So generally it is decided that number of occupancy of the people, depending upon that the money, the labor will give the money to the owner. So how the occupancy can be can be utilized. So my students have put weight sensor on the seat. Okay, so if someone is doing haircut, it requires 15 to 20 minutes. If someone is just doing shaving, it requires 10 minutes. So depending upon that occupancy, rough estimate of how much utilization of the seats per day was calculated, and then basis that how much money should get generated, that was calculated. So can you think such kind of applications? Now this is the IoT application, and it was real time telling the owner, okay, this is the occupancy, complete day analysis of the occupancy and this kind of things. So such kind of applications are very much possible. Only thing is we need to keep our eyes open. Okay, then the next thing is the time series data. When the data has been aggregated from very different sources, keeping the track in order at which it is happened. Like reading from sensor A was taken before reading from sensor B, or vice versa, will have a different implications in deciding the course of action of your applications. So that is something which is called as time series data. At what time, at what sequence I am capturing the data. Okay, so now you can see the frequency at which the data readings are taken is also important. So real time data is often not actually live because we are working with internet. So network connection is not going to be continuous. Sending very frequent reading may fog up the networks. Generally, that is what is happening when everybody tries to accept, or when large amount of data falls on a network, the network gets jammed. Okay, so live data readings might be taken at the interval ranging from few seconds to few minutes. Electricity meter sensor senses every second, 7 seconds, the data, and helps in knowing which appliances are on. Gas meter will only report 30 minute readings, gives only general trend. And with this, we have implemented our lab in Hyderabad campus, IoT lab only, where we have fixed a limit of data generation as 7 seconds. So there is a continuously, we are monitoring the temperature and humidity of our lab. And what we are considering, the data needs to be taken every 7 seconds, not prior to it, not after it. So when the temperature exceeds certain limit, we automatically switch on the fan. So the temperature goes down by that. So that is one of the live applications that we have utilized from this information. Okay. Then the important thing is characteristics of the data. In IoT data taxonomy, there are three important aspects. One is called as data generation. Another is called as data quality. And third is called as data interoperability. So again, in data generation, there are velocity, scalability, dynamicity, and heterogeneity. And in interoperability, there is incompleteness and semantics. And quality is decided by uncertainty of the data, redundancy. Redundancy is very important in medical domain applications, ambiguity, and inconsistency. So these are the characteristics of the data which are getting generated by IoT devices. Okay. So let us see what you mean by that. We have already discussed about velocity. Some sensors can scan up to rate at 1 lakh sensing elements, or sorry, 10 lakh sensing elements per second. So on one side, it is challenging to handle very high sampling rate as it requires efficient processing for fast generated data. And another side, once even if you process, it is very challenging to deal with the low sampling rate, because at some important information may be lost from data processing and decision making. So you have to decide what is the velocity at which, that is the optimum velocity at which you need to operate. Then the scalability, obviously, day in and day out, the data is going to get generated more. So your cloud computing or your edge or fog computing should be scalable to accommodate that data. Then dynamics, the data is going to change in real time. Then many things will be fragile. Generated data will change over the time due to the failure of things. Generally, in wireless sensor network, such kind of phenomena is observed. So connection between the things could be intermediate, create dynamics. And at the end, the heterogeneity. So many kinds of things potentially connected to the internet in future, ranging from cars, robots, fridge, mobile phones, to shoes. Actually, one of my students have developed smart shoes, where he has put some sensors in the shoes and analyzes the data of the jump, the speed at which it runs, and all this kind of thing. Then plants, watches already are smart now. They are generating data and so on. So this will generate the data with the different formats using different vocabularies. So we need to understand that. That is called as the heterogeneity of the data. Then quality, as I said, important aspects is uncertainty. Because if you are utilizing RFID, generally in many manufacturing industries, this RFID is getting utilized. The uncertainty can be referred to missing reading or reading of non-existing IDs. And same thing can be happen in the wireless sensor networks too. Again, redundancy, duplicate data means what redundancy. So RFID, again, data, the same tags can be read multiple times at the same location, because there are multiple RFID readers available at them. So there is no use of redundant data for me to process. It is just giving me additional load on my data management. Then ambiguity, like whenever there is a large amount of data, there will be always ambiguous data. Means what? You are not sure whether the data is correct or not. Okay, so and the data also produced by assorted things can be interpreted in a different way if due to different data needs. That is ambiguity in the data. And again, the last quality factor of data is inconsistency in the data. So again, taking one of the sensor as RFID, inconsistency can occur due to missing reading of the tag at some location along the supply chain. So again, same thing, sensing the data as when multiple sensors are monitoring the same environment and reporting the sensing readings. So if you have not calibrated that sensor, some might have variations in reading. So that constitutes the inconsistency of the data quality. And interoperability, the two important aspects of data in interoperability is incompleteness, means the data is not complete in the format which we are requiring. So hence, you cannot process that data with what you want. So that is where I am saying complete picture of relevant backgrounds of the real world is not available. So that is again really observable in IoT data. And semantics, that is to address the challenges posted by the deluge of IoT data things, machines. Major data consumer should be a promising trend of data processing in IoT. These are the various aspects. Now the last topic about data management is what are the various stages of IoT data lifecycle management, because that is very important. So these are the stages, and we will see what are the challenges associated with each stage. So create, that is select the known and trusted devices, collate, identify the suitable source of data, store, that is keep the data, cleanse, applying some algorithms so that unwanted data can be removed, and then process the data, align with the consumer behavior, retain, and purge. Purge means after a certain amount of days, you remove that data. So let us see one by one. So creation, collect, and store are one phase of the data. So when you create a data, the process of data creation should be aligned with the business case to mitigate the uncontrolled data creation. Means if you want to monitor the temperature, you should only select the temperature monitoring sensor, not temperature and humidity monitoring sensor. So that only temperature can be monitored and not humidity. That is where the selection of right devices and end user utilities for ensuring the relevant data collection. That is the data creation phase. And data should be ready to, when the data is generated, it should be ready for processing. That is optimizing the transformation and cleansing efforts. Then collation, that should identify the suitable sources to collate data relevant of present and future business need. That is the frequency at which the data, or the trigger point of the data collation, the mode of data collation, that is you want to collect data in the batches or in the real time, near real time, real time, should be defined. That is a collation. And storing, as I said, most important thing is unless until you store the data, you cannot go for further process. So for that is again, and the data is again scalable here to accommodate the growing data while ensuring cost effective and highly availability. The storage mechanism should be have the ability to coexist with the enterprise storage solution, and hence the cloud computing and the flexible storing mechanism comes into picture over here. That is distributed storage technologies, which will accommodate large volume, velocity, and variety of IoT data. The next is cleansing and processing the data. So cleansing means you apply a certain set of rules and parameters on the data, and you reduce the unwanted data from that. You apply certain machine learning or algorithms to reduce the further overheads. Then you process the data. That is the The logic should be taken into account with reference to your business case and data characteristics, aligned with the mode of data collection. Just like vibration data can be processed for detecting the failure or the for the predictive maintenance. So that is your business case is there. Okay. Then the last stage is retention and archival and purging of data. So you have to define the strategy, how much time you want to retain that data. Just like weather forecasting, I have worked with IMD, so they have the data from last 30, 35 years in their servers. They do not delete that data. So that is your retention policy, depending upon your business requirement. Then archive means you have to not keep that data as is, you have to shrink that data so as to fit that data in the lesser space. And purging means you are removing certain unwanted data. So the purging should always be performed on archived data, and the process should be aligned with the data governance policy and enterprises. The mode of data purging online and offline should be clearly articulated. So just like in your colleges also, na, you keep the record of the, or in university, you keep at least last 4 years question paper, yes or no? Sorry, answer sheet.
Yes, yes, sir.
Participants. 3 years to 4 years, right?
3 years to 4 years, correct. So that is the, and after that you purge it. Once the batch is passed out, you generally purge that data. So similarly, depending upon your company policies and other things, this is how the data management can be done in IoT. Now the last topic of today's session is very important, the security challenges or the types of attacks and threats that has been there in IoT. So it is not that it is something new, but now why it is becoming evident, because you are getting connected to internet by almost everything. You now you are doing banking through your mobile, correct? So internet is there on your mobile, you are sending funds through your mobile device, other things. So the security becomes very important. Okay, so in IoT, the scale and related, before starting this I will tell you a simple example how the breach of this has happened in US. So certain university students are like ethical hackers, what we call. They were playing with one automobile company, and they wanted to show that their network can be hacked, and it is a connected car. So they went into the car network through infotainment. Infotainment means what? The car person is listening to the live streaming or music through internet, not through the pen drive or some other things. But they have connected the infotainment system to the internet, and they are viewing the either video or audio through internet. So these intruders or these ethical hackers went inside the automobile or car network through infotainment system. And once you are there inside the network of the car, you have complete control of the car from the remote location. So what they did, they increased the volume of the music to the highest. They decreased the volume of the music to the highest. They increased the speed accelerator. They increased the speed of the vehicle. They decreased the speed of the vehicle. So, and then they left and they told that vehicle automobile company, this is how it is simple to hack your network. So this is the real life case study that has already happened in US some time back, where whenever you get connected to the internet, your vulnerability to such kind of attacks is becoming more. Second important thing is, which many of you as knowingly or unknowingly are doing, as we are now, everybody is there on WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, just to show off, I don't know what, but we post our family photos and other things on WhatsApp and Facebook, like 8 days family vacation at Goa. So that information on the social media is enough for intruders to come and burgle your home, intrude your home and take whatever belongings you have, because they know that complete family is in the vacation mode and they are all in the Goa. So as soon as you put all these things on the social media, on the internet, the vulnerability or the attacks becomes very obvious. And we feel privileged to, I don't know what it is, but just to show off or other things, we always try to put our social status and update it. And we expect that many people should like it also. There is a problem when many people like it, means your information, your personal information is getting passed to many people. Who will use it for what benefit, nobody knows. So we need to be very conscious when we are onto the social media platform. Never share your username, password on the WhatsApp. Never share your current locations or family vacation or any photos on the Facebook Live. Obviously, you can come back and you can post it. Nobody has told you not to post it. But in a hurry, now you are at Goa and you do a caption, I am with the family vacation time at Goa. That information is sufficient for intruders to come and take charge of your home and take your belongings. So this is the same thing with the IoT. If you don't have a secured IoT network or IoT device with various authentications, device level, application level, all these things, normal things can be breached, and then your bank accounts can be gone, or any things can happen. So that is the next 5-10 minutes we will discuss on that, how the things can be mitigated there. So as the millions of devices will get connected, and this is the amount of data that we are going to generate, so there is more and more vulnerability so that we can get attacked. So at its core, IoT is all about connecting and networking to devices, as I've told you. But whenever you connect and put it like refrigerator or your connected vehicle, they are creating the entry points to the network. So as I said, infotainment was an entry point to the network. Once a person breaches that security, he is inside your car, and with that, if he is in your network, he can do anything. Okay. Again, they follow the same kind of procedures. They try to detect the weak passcode, and once the weak passcode has been detected, then they enter into your network. So certain types of attacks, one is called as botnet. So what botnet is? Botnet is a network of systems combined together with purpose of remotely taking control and distributing malware. Malware is again one of the softwares which will come inside your system, and they will destroy your system files and other things. So the control of botnet operation via command and control servers, CNC servers, they are used by criminals on a grand scale for many things: stealing private information, exploiting online banking data, distributed denial of service, that is attack or spam or phishing mail. Means what? I don't know, have you experienced this, but we as an university have experienced this. Somebody unauthorized will take a generate and mail ID on the name of vice chancellor, and they will write a mail to all the people saying that this person is in need and transfer your funds to this account. So all these things are called as phishing mails, emails. Have you experienced such kind of things?
Yes, sir.
So there might be just one letter change in the email address, like vc@bitspilani.ac.in, instead of that vc1 or vc hyphen will be there. So it is very difficult to understand whether it has been sent by the VC or some other person. But again, your network administrators and all these things should be effectively checking all the emails which are coming to your servers, to your employees, and by seeing that they should be generating appropriate messages again, not to go with that. So we have At Bits Pilani, we have gone through such kind of events, so we know that. So again, distributed denial of services is again a kind of denial of service attack. Again, very important thing which we generally use, where multiple compromised systems, which are often infected by the trojan, is a kind of virus, are used to target a single system, causing this denial of service attack. So again, botnet as well as ThingBots consist of many type of devices all connected together, from computers, laptops, smartphones, tablets, and now also the smart devices. These things have two main characteristics in common. They are internet enabled and they are able to transfer data automatically via network. So all these are the characteristics of IoT that we have learned. Now, anti-spam technology can spot pretty reliability if one machine sends thousands of similar emails. But if multiple machines are sending the same emails, then it is very difficult to understand. And that is where these botnets and ThingBots are doing. They are operating with n number of different machines and they are sending the network traffic to your single machines. So when there is a huge amount of traffic on a single server, then it goes as a denial of service. So normal user will not be able to get into it. Have you noticed somewhere where for 18 to 45 age vaccination was on 3-4 days back? Registration was on at 4 p.m. Nobody was able to register it, yes or no? Has anybody experienced that? I'm talking about the recent.
Yes, sir.
Why? Because there was enormous traffic, enormous amount of requests to that. So it has become denial of service. So you are authenticating it by entering your OTP, which is getting generated. But the huge amount of network traffic is there on that server where you cannot get access to it. So that is called as denial of service.
Yes, sir. Recently we got.
Yeah. So similarly, there are people, those who will generate enormous amount of traffic by their laptops, computers, smartphone on a system, so that the normal user will not be able to get the services. Okay, so such kind of things have happened with HDFC and some other banking sectors also, where certain amount of time their network gets bombarded with such kind of things, or the user are not able to do the online transactions. So that is the loss of credibility of the bank and loss of customers. Then second concept of attack is man in middle. So man in middle concept is a mediator. Like if I am trying to tell you something, there will be a middle person which I don't know, and you also don't know, but he will take my words, he will manipulate my words, and he will tell you something others, and you will feel that I am only telling these words, and then you will have a different information from me. So that is something which is called as man in middle. So in Marathi, there is a famous thing, na, ghalcha ma kelta, something like that. Yes or no? Dhacha ma kela is the famous.
Yes, sir.
So that is something man in middle. It was Dharave. Someone changed it to Marave, and it has altogether a different meaning. So that is the concept here also. So there is some person who gets into our network. He listens to our talk. He interprets and he changes the talk and convey it to the other person in different manner. So the other person will act accordingly. So that is something. The attacker has the original communication. They can trick the recipient into thinking they are still getting the legitimate message. Okay. So that is the man in middle concept. Data and identity thief. I have already told you about that. Full of scary and unpredictable hacker accessing to data and money with all types of impressive hacks. We often also are our biggest security enemies. That is what we are. Carelessly safekeeping of internet connected devices, mobile phones, are playing into hand of malicious thieves and opportunities. then telling about our locations and other things. All these things are your identity, data and identity thief. Means they are taking on your data and then they are utilizing your data for their betterment. Social engineering, I have already told, act of manipulating people. So they give a confidential information. Either there is some message which is floating out that this is in problem, do that, this, that. And you go to that and then you try see that message is not at all appropriate. So that is social engineering, which can give you certain people can take your data and try to fish that data and hack your sites and do all this kind of stuff. As I said, we have already discussed about denial of service attack, which happens when the service would be usually unavailable. Okay, so again, one of the example of this was on the commercial bank. The loss of reputation affected company can still cost a lot of more of time and money. The same thing happened to the Cosmos back 2 years down the line at Pune. Some people breached their servers and many people's money was gone from their account. So if these kind of things are happening in the banking sector, definitely many people will opt out to keep their money in such kind of banks. So that is the effective implications of data which can be breached. So in IoT, assurance of privacy, as I said, Tata Motors does not wanted that data to be on the cloud. So they have implemented in their own servers. Similarly, what was the case with IMD, they don't wanted to put that data in the public cloud. So they asked us to deploy or generate the data which is compatible to their data in their servers. So that is something. Assurance of privacy. Okay, so an environment where home, office, appliances, all these things are being connected. So first thing is privacy is most important. So to ensure that the data is safeguarded and kept private. And only when the company starts doing this, there will be an assurance of privacy. So again, that is while your business is likely to be faced with enormous type of attacks over the time, main goal is not to get distracted by the exploit of the weak. So how to stay protected when you are designing your IoT applications? First thing is you should keep the security by design. Choose your design wisely. As I tell, there are certain microcontrollers nowadays which are coming with an inbuilt crypto engines, that is hardware level security. Then there is a software level security. Then there is a cloud level security, application level security. So when you are designing or deciding the hardware till the application, that is your security by design. Then operational reality you have to think. Then if failure happens, what are your survival points that you have to design? Then redundancy, as I've told, one of the common aspects that we have to be. Then the protocols, communication protocols, which will be sharing our information to the internet, whether those protocols are secured. All these things should be thought of first. That is first. Then the second thing is learn from the past. What are the types of attacks that have been happened at the past that you have to learn from them? The similar mistakes you should not do. Third is implementing the threat model and attack deals. Means once your prototype is ready, you are trying to impart some malware and security threats into it by yourself and checking that what is the response of your network or your security authentication on this kind of thing. So that is you yourself are trying to inculcate your viruses and malwares in the system and checking that whether this is prone to or this is able to sustain such kind of things. That is implementing the threat and model attack tree. And then monitoring trending threats and security standards. So there is a consortium of Cyber Security Council of India, again driven by NOSCOM. You should be a member of that, or your company should be a member of that, organization should be a member of that. So every now and then they will tell you, okay, these are the new trends which are coming that you need to be taken care while you're designing. Because as in the morning, Vaidya sir said, every now and then things are changing rapidly. The only thing is, until unless we have the knowledge is power, we cannot mitigate with it. Then continuously educate the system users, like this FDP is happening, like similarly in industry, there are continuous things are happening to educate the users of the devices, don't share the password with anybody, all these kind of things. So that is again a continuous process to enhance the security. Now, last two things are the attacks that are happened on IoT. So one is a malware attack whose name is Mirai. So this is a, if someone knows Linux, then they can understand that this is a busy box attack. It works by scanning the internet of host with an open port, that is 23, port 23, which is an open port when you are using the Linux machine. And using the weak password, generally the name of the user or name at the rate 123, or just password at the rate 123, that are called as a weak password vector. They try, and if some password or name of, generally for male, generally it is the name of their wife or name of the son, child, whatever. So these are all called as a weak password vectors. And this information can be captured by your social account. So I see your social account, I know your family members, I know your date of birth, I know your everything. And now with this vector, I enter into your device. And once I am inside your device, the malware is installed and contacts the CNC server, which awaits the further instructions. And when the CNC server instructs, all the bots under its command launch the flood of various kinds of traffic over willing to target routes. And it is the most well-known attack, and as it turns out, most infected in CCTV cameras. So it can infect the CCTV camera for the footage only. So if you know, the camera will not be able to stream live or give the footage. And if you can attack that, within that 10, 15, 20 minutes, you can rock or you can intrude and you can come out without even getting recognized. So that is the kind of attack, IoT attack. So this is, it does not, it contains the do not mess with the list of the servers that includes the General Electric, HP and US Department of Defense. The author of Mirai, who has generated this malware known as Anna Spy on Hack Forum, released the source code of this way back in September 30, 2016. After the source code was released in the open forum, this was taken and it was being attacked. The first attack was on the security blogger Brain Curve site on September 20, 2016. Another attack occurred on October 21, 2016, against UNS DNS provider Dyna, DNY, that disrupted the popular streaming services such as Netflix, along with Twitter, AirVPN, and others. The security researchers, which is Robert Graham of Errata Security Blog, presented an analysis of the attack in 2016 at RSA Security Conference in San Francisco. The author of Mirai attack, Paris Jha, Jocelyn White, and Dallon Norman, have been caught and pled guilty of leasing out their botnet army to the cyber criminals. The author managed to avoid the jail time from their part of Mirai, although Jha has been sentenced for 6 months of jail and over $8 million in fines for separate attacks on Rutgers University. So these are the kind of complications that has happened with one attack. Next attack is your BrickBot. So this is again Radware first warned about the potential attack. This is another BusyBox based attack. This malware Bricks the device makes it unusable, and hence the name is breakbox. Means it goes into your system and it destroys the system file. Your system is corrupted. You cannot use it, and that is called as permanent denial of services, PDoS. So it uses a command such as unix rm, that is remove, and with the command that reconfigure the kernel and finally reboot. Now useless the device. Device becomes useless. So again, saying this is again one of the things. Like these are the two attacks which have already happened and had catastrophic effect on the IoT. So that is all from my end. I hope you have got the insights.
Any questions?
Yeah, I am now open to the questions.
Can you please elaborate about hardware security, sir?
Yeah, so the latest things that as we are involved with ARM and teaching ARM in our curriculum, so the ARM Cortex M4 onwards, they have started implementing the hardware security in the processor, such as they have a crypto engines the in the processor itself, okay, at the kernel level, at the secure level, where you cannot enter into a secured level of the your hardware resources. Okay, then there are AES algorithms, 128 bit crypto algorithms. So you required basis which your software can do a secured boot. So unless otherwise you have a secured code enter while booting, you will not be able to boot and bring up the board, bring up process. So these kind of things have been started implementing at the hardware level. So you will get these features from ARM Cortex M33 onwards. Okay, so that is what is the things that are getting implemented at processor level, at the hardware level. So previously, the security or this encryption algorithms were part of your application protocols, where you have a random number generation which will be given on the mobile of your user, then you have to enter that random number generation, and then the authentication will happen. There will be 2-3 more types of authentications were there. Now the hardwares which are coming, the microprocessor and microcontroller people. Now again, ARM does not produce the controllers. They are just producing the processors and IPs. So whoever is utilizing Cortex M33 and onward in their like ST Microelectronics or Microchip, inherently they will get a hardware secured security by design.
Sir, do we have hardware security in sensors, sir?
As of now, I have not gone through or read certain articles. You can check with a website of IFM. IFM is a company which is a German-based sensor manufacturing company. There might be certain hardware security in smart sensor, but not in the normal sensors. So there are certain smart sensors which have the sensing element, which have the processor, which have the controller, and which have the Wi-Fi, or which have the communication protocol. So maybe at that level, certain hardware security might be added. But to be very frank, I am not aware of that. In normal sensor, conventional sensor, it is very difficult to add a security, because sensors are a device which will just sense the physical parameters and give you the requisite electrical or whatever the output you want.
So can how can we provide security to our IoT sensors, sir?
No, that is what I am trying to tell. Sensors are like in what aspect you want it to be secured. Sensor, the function of sensor is to sense the data.
Yes, okay. Sir.
So what kind of security you want? If your data our is coming to
us. Yes, sir. Our sensor data should not be read by other introduced.
So that is that we need not to give the security to the sensor. Whenever your sensor raw data is given to the end device, that needs to be secured, because as I said, raw data will not have the intelligent meaning to it. So security can be added at the device level, not at the sensor level.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I request coordinator of all these three phases and HOD of Computer Science Department, Professor S.V. Kulkarni, sir, to express thanks to Professor Manoj Kakde, sir.
Yes, thank you, madam. A very good afternoon to everyone, those who are attending this 1 week online FDP, which is on IoT first day schedule. On behalf of A.G. Patil Institute of Technology, Solapur, I, Professor Shripad Kulkarni, HOD Computer Engineering Department, as well as coordinator of this FDP, it is my great privilege to deliver a vote of thanks. So at first, I would like to sincere thanks to Professor Manoj Kakde, sir. Sir has given a very good information in today's three different sessions. So really, this information is very useful to build such IoT-based projects. So in very simple language, sir has explained some complex concepts using some real-time examples. So Manoj sir has focused on some important topics like all network layer protocols, database management system, as well as some security related concepts in IoT. So I would like to extend my sincere thanks to all the participants, because without you, it is not possible to conduct such type of FDPs. So within a 10 minutes, I will share you assignment link on WhatsApp group, as well as submit your response up to 5 p.m. Thank you.